I'm standing on Lexington Green. The date is April 19, 1775. Here stood 77 militiamen ready to defend their homes and hearts against the largest, most powerful army in the world. And this is where they made their stand.
In Boston, British Major General Thomas Gage ordered a surprise raid to Lexington and Concord to confiscate gunpowder and arrest Sons of Liberty leaders John Hancock and Sam Adams. Rider and fellow Son of Liberty Paul Revere took to his horse at midnight and rode through the countryside, warning of the approach of the British Army.
In April of 1775, Boston is an occupied town, and the British Army had a plan, and their plan was to take away the weapons and the gunpowder that the colonists had stockpiled in Lexington and Concord. And on the night of April 18, 1775, the British were going to go on a night raid into the countryside. Now, this steeple was going to be where the Sons of Liberty are basically going to warn Paul Revere, and he would go on his famous ride. And the famous saying was, one lantern if the British move by land, two if by sea. Two lanterns were shown in the steeple. Revere got on his horse and eventually got to Lexington and Concord first. So it was in this church that the signals were made. That night, warning the countryside about the British coming to Lexington and eventually Concord. He got to this point after he got to Lexington with the two other men, William Dawes and Sam Prescott, and he was taken captive by a British patrol. The two other men, William Dawes and Sam Prescott, escaped, and Revere was captured right in the spot. This is Buckman's Tavern. This is where the Minutemen assembled the night before. With the British coming down the road the next day, they would assemble on that green right over there.
As the British regulars' advance guard under Major Pitcairn entered Lexington, over 70 Lexington militiamen emerged from Buckman Tavern and stood in ranks on the village common watching them. Their captain was Captain John Parker, a veteran of the French and Indian War. Major Pitcairn rode forward waving his sword and called out for the assembled militia to disperse and said, lay down your arms, disperse ye rebels.
Here they stood, the 77 Minutemen, with muskets loaded, facing the most powerful military force probably the world has ever seen at that time. And all of a sudden, a shot was fired. We still don't know who fired that shot. But when that shot was fired, it was the beginning of the American Revolution. The colonists will lose 8 men. And they are buried right there at that monument.
Both Parker and Pitcairn ordered their men to hold fire, but a shot was fired from an unknown source. Witnesses at the scene described several intermittent shots fired from both sides before the lines of regulars began to fire volleys without receiving orders to do so. The militia broke and ran, spreading the word that blood had been spilled. The American Revolution had begun.
The 8 militiamen that died at the battle, right here in this green, are actually buried under this monument, including a guy by the name of John Harrington, who was hurt and he crawled actually to his doorstep, which is the house beyond the monument, and he died in his wife's arms shortly after being wounded.
The old burying ground behind Lexington and Green is one of the oldest burial grounds in the country, and the cemetery contains the graves of many prominent early Lexington settlers, as well as soldiers from the Revolutionary War and Civil War. Even a British soldier who was injured in the fighting at the Battle on the Green and died a few days later in Buckman Tavern. The Minutemen who fell on the Battle Green were originally buried here, but were disinterred and reburied on the Battle Green. Once order was restored in Lexington, the British troops formed a column and marched to Concord. In response to the raised alarm, the militiamen of Concord had mustered and assembled near a ridge about a mile near the North Bridge, where they watched the troop movements of the British troops. The ranks of the militia continued to grow as Minutemen companies arrived from other neighboring towns. The British soldiers arrived at North Bridge, searched the surrounding countryside for weapons, and then proceeded back across the bridge. The ranks of the militia swelled and battle commenced across the bridge. The regulars found themselves trapped in a situation where they were both outnumbered and outmaneuvered. The British column began to fall back to Boston, some 20 miles away. It proved to be a difficult journey. Behind me is the gravesite to the British casualties at Concord. The ones that were dead were buried here, actually. And these are going to be the first British casualties of the entire American Revolution. In their accounts afterward, British officers and soldiers alike noted their frustration that the colonial militiamen fired at them from behind trees and stone walls, rather than confronting them in large linear formations in the style of European warfare. This image of the individual farmer, musket in hand and fighting under his own command, has also fostered the American myth. Chasing the redcoats down the lane, then crossing the fields to emerge again under trees at the turn of a road, and only pausing to fire and load. To the contrary, beginning at the North Bridge and throughout the British retreat, the colonial militias repeatedly operated as coordinated companies, even when dispersed to take advantage of cover. All right, today I'm gonna shoot a 75 caliber brown bass musket with a ball down. So this is a live fire. First thing we do is we're gonna prime the pan. Take a little bit of gunpowder, pour it into the pan. I'm gonna shut the pan. Now I'm gonna save this priming powder for another shot. But what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna load about 90 grains worth of gunpowder down the barrel. I'm gonna wad it. I'm gonna take a 75 caliber bullet. Okay, I'm gonna pour that down the barrel. Gonna ram it down, make sure it's seated in the breech. Okay, now this thing is ready to fire. Let's see what we can hit. Caliber round ball going through his chest. It's going to take a chunk out of him and he's going to be out of the fight. As the British retreated from Concord, they were followed by angry colonists from all sides, probably hiding behind rocks such as this, or trees like that, behind these rock walls. Every step the British Army took, they met more casualties, and the fighting continued all the way back to Boston. This is the Captain William Smith house. William Smith is the brother of Abigail Adams. He's also one of the most important farmers in this area. As the battle took place along this road on April 19, 1775, one British soldier was wounded, and he walked up to that door, and he was taken in by the family and actually cared for about 3 or 4 days. Unfortunately, he did die,
But one of the last things he wanted to do was pay the family for their service, and he gave them a gold sovereign from his own coat. Today he's buried along this road. As the British made their way back to Boston along this road, there were several battles in the woods. This is one of the more famous ones. This is called Parker's Revenge, where the colonists, led by John Parker, who had fought at Lexington early in the morning, he had brought more colonists here as the British came back to Boston and fought them right on this spot. Now, they still do archaeological digs, and they still find out more information about this spot, and they know basically where it took place.